slip you some Boogie We Will. Coming at you live from the middle of nowhere, the center of everywhere, here once again to give you yet another dose of conversational boogie. This is the B-Sides and Rarities edition of Shift Happens. Do follow us on Twitter at Shift Happens Pod. You follow me, Gigi, over at GigiRabbit1. Ba-da-boom. And co-host for the evening, Cortana's a little under the weather tonight. So filling in is none other than Eric Awakening Man. What's happening, Eric?
Hey, bro. What's going on?
It's going on. And, yeah, we just got back from the UFO... the UFO Congress earlier today. Quite a wild weekend. I was there since Thursday. And, Eric, you were there on Wednesday, right?
Yeah, Wednesday night.
Yeah, and... Now, I'll tell you what, we're probably all pretty exhausted here, but you know what, we had to do a show this, I feel bad we left you guys hanging on Friday, but listen, folks, there was just so much happening at that conference, it only made sense to, it just didn't make sense to leave, so here we are for B-Sides and Rarities on Sunday, this fine Sunday, and we've got two very special guests. They'll be joining us in just a couple minutes here, and if, in case you haven't guessed by the title of the show, it is Jay Widener and Groovy Bean from the Reality Check Show. I'm sure you're all familiar with them on YouTube, and we got some stuff we're going to dive into tonight, as well as doing a little bit of a recap on what all went down. Hey, what's happening, Lee? Glad you can make it. And what's happening, everybody in the chat room? Thanks for tuning in. And I know we got some new listeners tonight. So if you're not familiar with this platform, one of the platforms we use is Spreaker, and that's where the chat room is. So if you want to hang out with all the cool kids, get your questions in, and just hang out with the audience, there's always great stuff happening there. Definitely get in the chat room. The quickest way to do it is just go to our website, shifthappenspodcast.com, click the B-Sides and Rarities menu option, and scroll down, you'll see the episode player. And right underneath the title of the current episode, there's a little text message icon looking thing. You click that, and then bam, that's how you get into the chat room. All right, so let's see what else. Oh, coming up this Friday, we're going to have Jeremy Corbell. That's right, he's going to be on the show this Friday. Looking forward to that. And man, what a good year he had at UFO Congress. He won the... he got Researcher of the Year, and then what was the other award he got? Do you remember, Eric?
I'm not sure. Film of the Year? Or...
No.
I have no idea. I'm sorry. I didn't go to the awards. He got all the awards in Laughlin like 4 months ago with Knapp. So, yeah, Knapp and Corbell are kind of cleaning house right now.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. And, all right, and... Let's see. Also, I do want to apologize real quick to the network. The last Friday when we canceled our show, long story short, the way we did it, it caused some technical difficulties over at the network. So sorry about that, guys. Thanks for your patience with that. All right, so let's go ahead and dive right in. So without any further ado whatsoever, ladies and gentlemen, Jay Widener and Groovy Bean. What's going on, guys?
Woo-hoo-hoo. Hey, happy evening, everybody. Yeah, and just to let the listeners know, hey, Groovy Bean here, folks. The other award, Gigi and Eric, was the Lifetime Achievement Award for George Knapp, but also Researcher of the Year, Jeremy Corbell with the EBE.
And then, but didn't Jeremy also get a second award? He got something else, too, didn't he?
Yeah, that was the EBE Award.
Oh, right.
Just telling everybody.
Did he win like the Extraterrestrial Biological Entity of the Year Award? No, I like Jeremy. He's a good guy.
Yeah, and then let's see. Who was it? Jack Roth. He's the one that won the Film Award for Extraordinary, The Seeding. So,
Where's Jay? Hey, Jay. How you doing, Jay?
Doing good. I didn't see any of those films. I did see the Bob Lazar film by Jeremy, and it was all right. I mean, if you want to believe Bob Lazar. But, you know, I like Jeremy. I've met him several times, and I applaud that he's making films that are interesting.
Yeah, what have you seen that one film he did, Patient 17, about Roger Lear and some of his patients? What did you think about that one?
That was a pretty weird film, I have to say, but it definitely shook up my reality.
Yeah, especially
You? Oh, sorry.
Oh, no, go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say, what did you find weird, Jay?
Just the entire scenario. I mean, you know, it's just the whole thing's weird. And I don't know. I've always been fascinated by that kind of thing. So I like the film. I actually think that was actually his best film.
I would have to agree.
I agree with you, actually.
Yeah. Absolutely. And, you know, especially for me, just watch, you know, those guys that are doing the analysis on these, you know, these things are finding in their body, and just the look on their faces and the reactions of what they're finding. That's what really got me, you know?
Yeah. I knew Roger Lear, and, you know, he definitely, before he died, he told me that, you know, he thought there were some very nefarious situations going on, you know, on this planet with the implants and things like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then, and not to mention, he died, he passed away during the making of the documentary.
Yes, he did. Not that I'm happy, because I really liked the guy. I thought for years before I met him that he thought that for some reason, I thought that he and Whitley thought the aliens were benevolent. And so when I actually met him, I think in 2008, and we had, you know, went out for drinks or whatever, I thought, wow, this is really incredible. He really thinks that these are nefarious aliens, which totally surprised me. Yeah.
Yeah.
Wait, you're talking about Whitley?
No, Roger. Both Roger and I met them both at the same night. And I kind of, you know, I'd read Whitley's first two books, and I always thought, oh, these guys that are coming into his room at night are, you know, he thinks they're friendly and they're good and they're helping humanity. And of course, I never thought that, but I mean, I thought if they're coming into your house at night, they can't really be all that good without telling me anyway. And so I never understood. But when I finally met him in 2008, and I realized that both Whitley and Roger thought there was a nefarious alien plan going on, then I kind of changed my attitude about him.
Yeah. And
Roger Lear, what kind of doctor was Roger Lear?
I can't remember now.
He was a surgeon of some kind, if I'm not
mistaken. Yeah, he was. He was a surgeon, that's right.
Yeah.
And somebody came to him and asked him to get an implant, and he did an x-ray and saw the implant, decided to do the surgery, and then he actually dug it out of the body, and that, you know, put him on the path that he went on for the rest of his life.
Yeah, indeed.
Jay, did you ever get a chance to talk to Daryl Sims and kind of compare his story with Roger Lear's and kind of put that puzzle together at all?
No, I never got a chance to talk to Daryl Sims. To be honest with you, I'm not really ufologist guy. I'm more of a guy who's into you know, weird technologies and things, and so I just kind of brushed up against the UFO thing, and my study of Gnosticism and the Archons always led me to believe that there was a nefarious force invading us. But until, like I said, until my 2008 episode with Whitley and Roger, I had thought that because I was ignorant of the ufology community for the most part, I thought they were all like love and light, and the aliens are coming here to help us, and everything is going to be good. And maybe that's true. I don't know. But that's not my study of history or philosophy. My study is that there's a nefarious force here. There probably are good forces. I believe that there's divine forces at work within the human race, but to say that the aliens are coming here to save us, I just don't know if that's I just think it's a dubious position.
Yeah, and on that note, I like to ask this question to as many different people on this show as possible, just to get as many different, you know, opinions as possible, and that's this, for the both of you. what is it about humans that, you know, is so, because it would seem like we're like the center of attention for all these different races, and what is it about us that is so fascinating to them? Or is that just our perspective?
No, I think we actually are an experiment of some kind, and that what they're doing is they're trying to, it would seem that there's two different, or more than two different purposes for our design. And it seems, you know, our original purpose seems to have been to create a kind of engineering species, a species that could create things out of nothing, take sand and silica and turn it into computers and that kind of thing. But lately, and I'm saying this because I'm really concerned about it, is that there seems to have been a change in direction somewhere around 1980, 1990, somewhere in there, where another force is intervening and is actually ruining our chance at becoming a race of people that can achieve something extraordinary. And that worries me. And that's when I actually decided to intervene and come out publicly, because I could sense that there was this dark force that was changing us. And, you know, I call those the Archons, because I borrow from the Gnostic text. But I'm very concerned. Ruby, what do you think?
So why are humans the center of attention? I think it's because we're biologically malleable. We're biochemical machines. And, you know, going back to the whole implant ideology, whether you're somebody who believes you have an implant or whatever, I go there and I think about our own medical implants, and is it possible that some of the technology we're currently using on our bodies, did any of those types of ideas, metals, etc., come from any kind of previous alien technology and or things that were found in recovered species? Is that possible? I think it is, but I do think that we would make an easy target. Just look at how we all treat one another too, right? The programming. Look at the programming that's going on and how society, how we all treat one another, right? So I would think an alien race would be looking at us like, how do we attach the strings? How do we manipulate the situation? I think it's biological.
They may look at us like complete chumps because we're so easy to fool. I mean,
right.
We go to the doctor and we believe what the doctor tells us, and the doctor injects us with whatever. We don't even know. We don't even ask. And then, you know, what do we know? What kind of secret experiments are going on, you know, that aren't really conspiratorial? They're more what I would call corporate. I'm moving more and more towards a corporate kind of thing than a government kind of thing. I don't think the government attracts really highly qualified, high IQ people. I know for a fact, because I know a lot of people who work in the government, and they're very, very flatline. But I know that the corporations can afford to pay, you know, high IQ talent a lot of money. So, you know, you're going to choose between working for the government for $200,000 a year and working for a corporation for, you know, $1.2 million a year. The corporations are going to win out. And I think Richard Dolan talked about this in a recent YouTube show, where all of the intelligentsia, all of the highly intelligent people are now moving into these secret corporate programs. And I think in the medical field especially, we see them using the regular people who go into hospitals and into clinics and things as experiments. And And they don't even think they're experiments. They think they're helping us, right, Grievy? But they, yeah, I mean, the nurses and the doctors don't really think they're involved in something nefarious.
Exactly.
Right. I think there's definitely an undercover. It's my opinion that your local hospital, your local emergency clinic, all these, from my own personal experience, I feel, there are black ops right underneath your local healthcare facility. And a lot of it, too, you have to wonder with Big Pharma and anything privately owned and take a look at the devices that they're pushing. But so I'm wondering, from those technologies, these devices that are being implanted, is some of that technology coming from, right? Is it coming from anything that we have yet to see that's been, you know, from back, who knows, any alien crashes? Could we take it that far? I don't know.
Sure.
But I find it very interesting what's going on. And when you're someone who has had an experience, not just one, but several, through the healthcare system with this scenario, and you find things out and you understand and you are told you've been used as a human guinea pig. So that's I think people really need to wake up to. And it's a serious situation. And really taking a look and gather up all the different types of devices that are being pushed. There's a documentary out there, actually, that's called The Bleeding Edge. That would be a good place to start for folks. But
trying to scare anybody either, but, you know,
going
to a hospital, you're walking into a black ops program, I hate to say it. And again, I want to make sure everybody realizes, I'm not saying the doctors and the nurses are involved. They really aren't. It's the pharmaceutical companies that are encouraging certain kinds of behavior and things. And so we're being, you know, our children are being given vaccinations, sometimes 20 to 30 vaccinations before they're 5 years old. And this is unprecedented in human history. And you have to wonder what the forces are behind this kind of thing.
Right. Well, yeah, it's definitely Big Pharma, but I have to disagree with you there, Jay. There are doctors that know exactly what they're doing. I've personally dealt with one face-to-face.
I agree with that. I just want to chastise the entire medical community, because
they're
really good doctors and nurses for helping people.
Sure. It's about awareness and to be savvy and ask those questions to your medical providers and thoroughly find out what is exactly it is that they want to implant. And, you know, we could bring up there's a pediatric system that they brought up for kids with attention deficit disorder. So ADHD, ADD, however you want to say it. And it's actually called the Monarch. No joke. It is called the Monarch ETNS system. And it hooks up and connects to brainwaves. So if that's not a red flag, I don't know what is.
there certainly are a lot of, you know, doctors and nurses that, as far as they know, they're just going by the book, what they went to school for, and they, you know, they genuinely think that, you know, they're helping people. They really, a lot of them have no idea.
In a lot of ways, they are helping people, and I don't want to discourage people from becoming nurses and doctors. It's just that they have to be aware of what's really actually the underlying plan, and be aware of that. And I would say go into a more naturopathic kind of way, and away from the pharmaceuticals if you can.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. I agree.
Mm-hmm. Pay attention to the devices and what is exactly what it is that they're trying to do. What mind bending, body changing, right? Even body modification on the inside. That's what's happening.
Yeah, and it also feel like with lots of very common medications, you know, like SSRIs and like antidepressants and stuff. I feel like sure it might be helping this symptom or that. But at the same time, I feel like it's affecting those kinds of drugs affect you on a spiritual level to where it kind of just messes up your frequency, and it's kind of hard to stay center, to sound cliche.
Absolutely. They absolutely mess with you on a huge level. I don't know if it's a conspiracy or a side effect. I don't really care. I just have friends who I've seen go down, and I don't really... I know that it seems like an easy thing to do is to rely on an SSRI, but I really have to say that I would do everything I can to resist going on one of those. I think they're a terrible mistake. I think that they cause a lot of suicides and also accidents. And I just, you know, I'm really, I just have too much experience with them. I really say if you're thinking about doing it or your kid's going to do it, I would really think about maybe getting some exercise instead, taking a long walk for an hour and a half a day, or working out with weights or doing yoga. I think would go a long way to alleviate the symptoms that you that would be alleviated by the SSRIs. I think one of the things that's really going on is that human beings are not working out enough, not exercising enough, not walking in nature enough, and that is causing a lot of our mental disorders.
Yes, absolutely. I agree. And then right along with that, I mean, you know, learn how to properly, you know, get into deep meditation. I mean, that, yeah, just that in itself as well.
Yes, I agree. There's a lot, many alternatives to drugs, and I would highly recommend that you try them.
Absolutely. Right, and I'm going to put a disclaimer out there for myself. I'm not a doctor, nor am I a nurse. When I speak for folks that are new maybe to me, I'm speaking from my own personal experiences and, you know, opinions. But, yes, yeah. Just want to say that.
Oh. Yeah, and, that was one of my experiences, you know. Just, I used to be on antidepressants, and I noticed it was a lot harder to meditate when I was taking those things.
Oh, yeah.
Well, see, and you have to, for myself, I think that these medications, they mess with your brain waves. They mess with your brain. So, you know, you're taking all these types of medications, and then what is it that they're not telling us that happens with the entire process of consciousness, right?
Yeah.
I mean, there's medications out there that actually seem to cause brain injury. And so if I were to give somebody an opinion about that, it would be like gabapentin. So.
Yeah. Yep. And have either of you done the sensory deprivation tanks?
Oh yeah, many times.
Yeah, that does wonders in itself right there.
It does. In fact, I highly recommend it. If you get into water that's your skin temperature and float there in that state for an hour, it's more soothing than any drug, because you're receiving endogenous tranquilizers. Endogenous meaning, you know, your body's creating them. And that's what you really want. You want to create endogenous drugs, which means your body produces certain kinds of drugs, serotonin and all sorts of things, and you want to encourage that. That's what meditation, yoga, and all these things do, is they encourage the release of endogenous drugs inside the body, created by the body, that are you and a reflection of you, and that is really the way to go.
Our bodies essentially can produce just about everything that we really need. It's just a matter of, you know, learning how to put your body in the right situation and state of mind to be able to do so.
That's right. The ancients created many techniques, which were just about that. I mean, that's what they were all about. And so, you know, you go to Egyptian or Indian or Native American or ancient Siberian shaman, and you find out that all these techniques have already been perfected. You don't need to go create new ones. There's all sorts of ways to create an endogenous chemical release in your body if you just know the physical techniques to do it.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, all right, now I want to switch gears a little bit here. So, I've thought about this before, but you, the way you were explaining it at the concert, or the concert, the conference, rather, which in a way it's kind of like a concert, I guess. But, you know, we started talking about, you know, how plasma might be responsible for a lot of, you know, things that are happening in the UFO community. And well, I guess we'll take a step back and start with what you call the secret fire of alchemy.
Yeah, so, you know, in alchemy we have the four elements, which is earth, air, fire, and water. And you know, if you actually examine that, it follows almost exactly the physics of the four things that make up our universe, which is liquid, gas, solids, and plasma. Those are the four things that make up our universe. Well, if you transfer that to the four elements of alchemy, earth is solids, gas would be air, the water would be the liquids, and then, of course, plasma would be the fire. So the secret fire of alchemy, I believe, is plasma. And if we look at plasma, we see that it, you know, is literally 99% of the universe. And so I'm reading a book by the Iranian physicist Keshe right now, and he talks about how we have a complete misunderstanding of our universe with Einsteinian physics and with Newtonian physics, and that actually there's this force, an invisible secret force, for the most part. Sometimes you can see it, but for the most part, it's invisible, and we're floating in it. Like, imagine that you were a fish, and you would never know that you were in a, you know, floating in a sea, because it would just be ubiquitous and part of your reality. You would never even question that there was this water around you, because it was just part of you. But that is what I'm saying, is that we're living in an etheric universe, a plasma universe, and we're literally floating in this. And in this plasma universe are millions and millions of different beings and intelligences and sentiences that we can't see, that lie right outside our ability to see and hear. And sometimes we can. And, you know, some people have the ability to see these things and tell us about it. And, you know, Madame Blavatsky and Ledbetter, and recently Barbara Brennan, who's written many books on the light body, and they have the ability to see it and tell us about it. And, you know, it's the chakras, and it's the etheric ocean that we live in, and it's all of the things that strike us as being paranormal, I guess you would say. And once we understand, and I believe that this is the next wave of our understanding of both UFOs and the paranormal, is through understanding that we're living in a plasma universe, and that everything is connected via these streams of plasma that don't give a damn how far apart objects are, because they're instantaneously connected through the plasma electric universe. The sun is plasma, the stars are plasma, nebulas are plasma. There was a wonderful exhibit at the UFO Congress of a guy who had a telescope taking pictures of stars and nebula and galaxies, and it was all plasma. You could just see it if you knew what you're looking at. And I'm really trying to become the person that's pushing forth this new idea of reality, that we're dealing with a substrate of energy that we can't see, and it connects us all. And psychedelics are associated with this, and paranormal experiences. Ghosts are just plasma beings who are lost. And I'm only at the very beginning. I'm 5 feet into a 1,000-mile trek, and I can feel that it's going to have great rewards. And it's a fascinating field, and I could go on and on about it.
Yeah, and I was very fascinated about, we're talking about this over the weekend, and because, I mean, a lot, you know, you know, as being, you know, flesh and blood beings, and every form of life that we know is, you know, physical and, you know, carbon based. But that doesn't mean, you know, I think people overlook, you know, the possibility or probability that their, you know, consciousness could probably find its way into, like, maybe, you know, a plasma being, or if not, maybe even like a, like, I don't know. I always have this feeling that on Saturn, you know, on those gas planets, well, what if there's, you know, beings that instead of a meat body, they have a gaseous body, you know?
Well, that's right. And again, you know, think about, okay, so let's say that there are, what I'm postulating is that there's a universe that we are like creatures in an ocean, living at the bottom of the ocean, on the floor of the ocean, and all around us are creatures floating in the ocean around us, but we don't know it. And the ocean is huge above us, and it's filled with millions of living creatures that are not carbon based. And so then, you know, and again, there's I one of your friends at the conference had a number of photographs taken by a friend of his in Sedona, I believe. And I mean, these were the most amazing plasma based, you know, photographs I've ever seen. Again, if you even Google in the term skyfish, you'll see that there's a number of photographers who have captured some of these etheric creatures on photography and imagery and video. And so you have to wonder, you know, what's going on here. And I believe that a lot of the UFO phenomena can be explained by this plasma universe that we actually live in. And there's a guy on the web called Suspicious Observer who talks about this all the time, and he does daily Earth weather reports based on this kind of plasma science, and he's incredibly accurate. And once you understand it and get it, it becomes like easy to understand why we're telepathic, why we are extremely special creatures, because we have this weird relationship with this plasma energy because of certain physical traits that humans have. And again, you know, your blood is plasma, your brain is plasma, we are plasma. And when we die, our plasma bodies leave and go back into the plasma ocean, which we're surrounded by. And again, that's what the Akashic Records are. The Akashic Records are our memories being inserted into the plasma ocean of knowledge that surrounds the Earth and all the universe. This also explains, by the way, why the Milky Way galaxy, and all galaxies actually, they don't, when they spin and rotate, they don't rotate with the inside of the galaxy going faster than the outside of the galaxy, which is what you would expect in rotational dynamics. What goes on in galaxy formations and rotation is that the outside of the galaxy and the inside of the galaxy are rotating at exactly the same speeds. This tells me that the galaxy is actually one being, one thing, and that it is one gigantic plasma being. And so when we go back to the Vedic texts of India, and they tell us that there's this, you know, force at the center of the universe and ancillary forces that are surrounding that central force, and then smaller ancillary forces surrounding that force, until you get down to humans, that tells me that we're living in Indira's net, which is a chain of plasma orifices and sentient beings that are plasma oriented, and that the entire universe is plasma. And when the human race finally realizes this, we will have access to free energy, free zero G energy, and also be able to travel using ships that can ignore gravity. Gravity is not what excuse me, gravity is not what we think it is. Gravity is actually an electromagnetic force. That just like when a magnet holds, you know, it magnetizes and attracts something, the Earth is a giant magnet, and it's attracting us and everything else to its surface. And once we understand that, then we see that the universe is actually electromagnetic. Gravity does exist, but it's a subsidiary force to the larger dynamic of electromagnetism and plasma.
Yes, I've always thought that too about gravity. I mean, if you ask any, as far as mainstream science goes, I mean, they really do not know what gravity is. They can describe its effects,
exactly right.
But even Neil deGrasse Tyson will tell you, like, we can't explain what it is. But it's electromagnetic. It has to be in nature.
It is. And in fact, T. Thompson Brown, who I consider the greatest American-born scientist, you can watch his videos on YouTube. He's inventing machines that are defying gravity. He was in the 50s. I believe that he created he and Tesla together created the anti-gravity waves. And he called it electrogravitics. In fact, naming it as electromagnetism. So,
yeah.
I mean, you know, what can you say when you argue? Are you going to argue with someone like T. Townsend Brown? I mean, you know, and so this is the big secret they've been hiding from the 50s, that we live in a plasma universe. They don't know how to tell us. They've developed super high technology, including our plasma televisions, by the way, from this kind of discovery. And I'm kind of determined to get it out. I'm kind of determined to spend the rest of my life getting all these secrets out. And I have to tell you, this book that I'm reading by Keshe, that's K-E-S-H-E, he's Iranian. I cannot pronounce his first name or I would. So forgive me, Keshe, if you're listening. I hear you're a fan. And I highly recommend it if you have a technical, scientific kind of mind. It's a very deep book, and I can give you the name of it. If you like,
yeah.
But it is incredible, and I think that we are moving right now into an area that's certainly explosive as far as knowledge.
Yeah. Okay. Now, what is the name of that book?
I'm looking it up right now on the internet, so I'll tell you in a second.
All right. Cool. All right. Cool. And while you're looking that up, so what do you? Random question here, although we briefly talked about this the other day, but what do you, Coral Castle, how do you think that, what happened there? What do you think that guy was doing?
Oh, well, absolutely exactly what I just described to you.
Okay.
I've been there. I've read his book. I'm forgetting his name at the moment. The name of the book is The Universal Order of Creation of Matters by Mehran, M-E-H-R-A-N, I'm not going to say his middle name, too weird, and then Keshe, K-E-S-H-E. If you're technically minded and you're a nerd like me, you will love it. You have to read each page like three times, but hey, that's what you go through. So Coral Castle, what he did was, do you know his name? Can you remind me of his name, the guy, the little short?
Yeah, Ed Leeds Golden.
Yeah. Okay, so what he did was he came here from Latvia. He was a Latvian.
Right.
Latvians have, by the way, some of the highest IQ people on Earth. And he came here and he realized that coral had this kind of quality of attracting in plasma. And what he did, I believe, was he created a very simplified technology that allowed him to remove the gravity from the coral. We have the story of the workman who came up to his place with I believe it was an 80-ton slab of coral. Not 80, maybe 8-ton. Maybe 8-ton. I think it was 8-ton. 8-ton slab of coral on his truck. And then he said, listen, I've got the coral here, and the guy told him, okay, you know, go to lunch and then come back, and we'll get this thing off your truck. And when he came back from lunch, it was already off the truck. And so in 1 hour, he had levitated it out of its position on the truck and moved it over to its position on Coral Castle, which has literally got hundreds of thousands of tons of coral stacked together. And he uses all sorts of alchemical symbols also at the Coral Castle thing. And I believe alchemy, by the way, of course, because the secret fire is plasma. And if you actually look at alchemical drawings, you can see that they're really mostly the art of alchemy is depicting plasma figures and beings and symbols. So I believe that he actually had somehow figured out the what I'm telling you, only he was smarter than I am, because I can't go and actually make machines that actually tap into this energy. But I believe Coral Castle is actually his monument to his understanding of this plasma physics.
Yeah, and he left so many breadcrumbs, too. If you really sit there and look, from the alignments of all of the structures and everything, I mean, he really... Yep. You know, it's almost like a, it's like a game. And but
yeah. It is. And if you read Keshe's book, which I was just doing before our show, he's talking about how you have to have the right planetary alignments and star alignments to get the plasma in the right state to excite it in the right degree so that you can actually utilize it in some way. So it's fascinating.
Yeah. And then that definitely makes sense as to why a lot of most, if not all, megalithic structures around the world, the ancient ones, they're all built on intersections of electromagnetic ley lines.
They are, and that's what ley lines are, would be their plasma lines. They're lines where the plasma is like the stream, the weather that goes in a stream around the Earth. Well, there's plasma that does the same thing. And that's what the ley lines are doing. They're tapping in and showing us where these are, and so you can build your power places there to tap off this incredible energy that we in our modern world are completely ignoring and acting like it doesn't exist. But think about it. Science tells you that there's four states of matter. There's solids, liquids, gases, and plasma. The alchemists are telling us that there's four states of matter. There's earth, wind, solids, earth, wind, water, and fire. But fire isn't something that exists in the natural world as a steady state. I mean, earth does, and water does, and air does. But fire is something that has to be created by a volcano, or it has to be started by a human, or created by lightning or whatever. But plasma, if you just replace fire with plasma, plasma is the secret fire, which the alchemists tell you that you cannot do your alchemy until you understand what the secret fire is. And the secret fire is that which does not burn. So I am totally convinced that plasma is the secret fire, and that the breakaway civilization, you might say, or the people that are in charge of what we're doing, they know this, and they've been using plasma for a long time.
Yeah, and I mean, I would imagine one of the reasons why it's been kept secret so long is, so much of our economy is based on the fact that you have to pay for energy,
right?
But also, of course, to stay ahead of us and all that good fun stuff.
Yeah, it is all based on that, and they know it, and they're doing everything they can. Even now, they're moving towards saying, okay, so we're going to cut down all the coal power plants, we're going to cut back on the natural gas plants, and we're going to go to solar. Of course, solar is not going to work. I'm sorry. I love solar. I have solar in my house. It's not going to work. It's a great thing for short term, but it isn't beneficiary to the environment. It costs a lot of money to make solar panels. They're doing everything they can to hide the plasma energy, which is also called zero point energy, even to the point where you know, they're destroying the careers of anybody that actually looks into this. A guy I know, Eric Dollard, he's I think he's finally not living out of his car, but he's one of the geniuses of the world right now, and he invented a plasma-free energy device and had his life destroyed. And we're really getting, you know, to the point where we have to realize that the powers that be do not want this information out. And we have to say to them, screw you. We're going to go this way. And I'm hoping maybe even today there's like a very rich millionaire, billionaire listening and says, yeah, I want to start, you know, funding Keshet and some of these other scientists that are looking into this, because I believe that. I'll tell you what. Here's what I know. I know that when YouTube censors something, it must be true. And I know that the plasma physics and all the alternative physics sites are being suppressed. So that tells me that we're on the right track.
Yeah, and it's and first of all, Eric Dollard, yeah, he's might be one of the smartest humans on the planet. But also it's just ridiculous. It's almost, you know, it's like what's his name said, you know, it's like suppressing the car automobile advancement because it's going to put the horse and buggy industry out of business.
Right.
You know.
That's exactly right. And when they first invented electricity, you know, 100 years ago or whatever, 120 years ago, the big fear, if you read the newspaper articles, is that the people at last light gas lamps and they're all going to be put out of business. It was going to be this horrible thing that was going to destroy the economy. We have to stop the advancement of electricity. And, you know, and this is what happens every time we come up against an advancement. And we have to, like, stop with the ridiculousness, because we're not going to go backwards when we finally understand zero-point plasma-free energy. It's going to release us from slavery.
Yeah. Yeah. And, yeah, like a lot of people say, you know, we should be at least 100 years more advanced than we are right now.
Well, Groovy and I did a show a few weeks ago with Walter Bosley called Project X, and that's what that's about. It's about how there's a group of humans that are a lot more advanced than we are because they understand what I'm trying to tell you, there are some people within this breakaway civilization that want us to succeed, and there's some that want us to fail. And the ones that want us to succeed are, you know, helping us as best they can by feeding people like me and others information. But, you know, it's as H.G. Wells says, it's a race between education and disaster.
Yeah. And, okay, so let's see. So we do have we got a break coming up, and I did want to switch gears again. Unless Eric or Groovy had anything to add to that.
Oh, that was just fascinating to listen to. Absolutely. No, I was just thinking about Tesla, like the Birkeland currents.
Oh, yeah.
And just the whole, the electric universe there, and just what Tesla truly knew, what was hidden from us that has to do with the plasma universe. But coming from the experiencer side of things, for those out there that maybe had near-death experiences, so just referring to that, I've had one myself, and I experienced going through the plasma field. So, you know, it's just something to think about, but it's, you know, the whole, what exactly did Tesla know? That that is just hidden. It's fascinating. So
no, he knew a lot, and he knew
right. Everything
I'm saying, and probably 5,000% more. And, of course, been decimated into the dustbin of history by Einsteinian science, which doesn't and absolutely forbids any inquiry into what I'm talking about. So you can make that what you will.
Yeah. And, okay, so, all right, let's go and take a break, and then when we come back, I want to dovetail right where we are into the secret space program. Definitely want to pick both of your brains about that. So, ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to B-Sides and Rarities edition of Shift Happens Here. And we'll be back in just a few short minutes with the Jay Widener and the Ruby Bean. Don't go anywhere.
Okay, here we go. AncientLifeOil.com. AncientLifeOil.com. Now, this is for CBD. AncientLifeOil.com. Again, for CBD. Where do I get CBD? AncientLifeOil.com. It's pretty good stuff. Organic, non-GMO. We are the Ferrari of CBDs. AncientLifeOil.com. You know, they say when you mention a person's name three times when you first meet, that you're going to remember. So I'd say to you, nice to meet you, AncientLifeOil.com. It's AncientLifeOil.com, right? Nice to know that you help people. AncientLifeOil.com. Think about this. Occasional stress, occasional anxiety, occasional inflammation, occasional stiffness, and intruders that get you down. AncientLifeOil.com. Okay, so I'm going to give you a fact for the day. So Ancient Life Oil does not help you with business deals. Hold on a second. If you feel better, it could help you make a better decision. Okay, I'm wrong. Just remember to go to AncientLifeOil.com.
From birth, we have been conditioned to conform to what is normal, conditioned to adhere to authority, and conditioned to repeat what has been told to us as truth. I'm Ryan Gable, and here at The Secret Teachings Radio, I've interviewed hundreds of great guests and done extensive unique research into subjects that span from the paranormal and the occult to health, philosophy, and history. I personally have no affiliations or agenda, except to use objective critical thinking in my analysis of every subject discussed, to empower myself with information, and hopefully allow you to do the same. If you want to join me, tune into the Secret Teachings radio broadcast, airing live Monday through Friday from midnight to 3 a.m. U.S. Pacific Standard Time on The Fringe FM. For more information, you can visit our website at www.thesecretteachings.info or email me at rdgable@yahoo.com.
Pure Health Defenders, proud sponsor of Shift Happens, producing organic and natural health, wellness, and technology products for people, pets, and plants to thrive alive. Pure Health Defenders, also known as PHD, is powered by C7 Technology, Scalar Energy, Atomic Technology, and fueled by Sea Miracle Superfoods. 118 nutrients of the purest sea vegetables Mother Earth has to offer. Recognized 100% by people, pets, and plants, delivering the value the same. Everybody deserves a PhD. Be smart about it. Come join the healthiest family today.
Kids, don't drink in park. Accidents cause people. This has been a PSA brought to you by your friends at Shift Happens and The Fringe FM.
Hey guys, do you struggle with low testosterone levels? Symptoms of low testosterone affect your optimum functioning as a man, and this includes loss of motivation, fatigue, and lack of libido. Well, now there's a way to increase your testosterone levels and combat these symptoms, and do it naturally. How? It's called Red Stag for Men, the all-new male enhancement formula designed to do just that. Red Stag is formulated with some of the most frequently studied natural ingredients that are known to raise higher testosterone levels. Higher testosterone levels have been known to increase your drive, as well as reduce body fat, improve lean muscle mass, and boost your energy. Red Stag is taken once daily, yet works all day naturally. So go to MyRedStag.com right now and get your 60-day supply. Red Stag. Remember, take the red pill. Proven ingredients. Proven performance. Go to MyRedStag.com right now. That's MyRedStag.com.
Hey, is that a new music app?
Yeah, check it out. Surfer Music Discovery. It links to thousands of online stations, but the twist is you see the song names and artists that are now playing live.
That's different. No guessing. Looks like a waterfall of music.
So many formats. Rock, oldies, country, R&B, jazz, and a whole lot more.
How's that spelled?
Surfer. S-U-R-F-R.
Is it expensive?
It's free. No need to sign up or sign in.
Get the Surfer Music app free from Google Play or the App Store.
KTLK Digital Broadcast. We rock the paranormal talk.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the B-Sides and Rarities edition of Shift Happens. We're here tonight with Jay Widener and Groovy Bean from Reality Check. We just got back from the UFO Congress today, and amazing weekend. And we had some fascinating conversations, and we figured we'd bring some of those to the table here. Also joined by Eric Awakening Man, our guest co-host for the evening. And so, all right, let's dive right back in. Now, first, we got a question from the audience for Jay. K28 wants to know, what do you think of the face on Antarctica?
The face?
Yeah.
I don't know what that is.
Oh, you haven't seen that?
No.
Okay. Yeah, it's very, Jimmy's been talking about it a bit lately. And, it's like... it reminds me of the face on Mars. I mean, it looks like a face, and it's just right there.
Is this on Google?
Jimmy did a really good video. If you go to his YouTube channel, he posted it sometime in the last couple of weeks, I think. And he gives you a good little introduction to it and, shows it to you from a bunch of different angles. And, yeah.
Well, I'll tell you what I think. Just as an aside, about 25 years ago, a friend of mine who was a really good researcher, traveled all over the world and everything, had a lot of money inherited, and so he was able to look at these things. And he had a book, which I've never been able to find again. And it was written and photographed by a German woman, and I don't know who her name is. And what she did was she went all over the earth photographing mountains and, canyons and things. This is before, you had drones or anything. This was years ago. And she found many, many mountains and cliffs that seemed to be eroded human faces, as if there was some kind of civilization here a long, long time ago that had gone out and created like Mount Rushmores, but everywhere, in Peru, in Switzerland, everywhere, in the Rockies, take mountain faces and humanized them. So it wouldn't surprise me that something would appear.
Yeah. Yeah, okay. And, all right, well, thanks for the question, Kay. Now, Groovy, have you seen the face on Antarctica?
Yes, I have. Indeed. I have. It's compelling. We don't know, right? You can't prove it one way or the other. I mean, but you can look at the image. It's kind of like the image on Mars. Well, is it shadows? Is it the perspective? Is it what's on the terrain?
Yeah.
Where's the angle of the sun when this is seen? You know, I want to get there so I can verify it.
Yeah.
And that's the problem, is they won't let you into Antarctica to look at any of this. So.
Yeah, which
exactly.
Yeah, I've got a lot of great questions about Antarctica, but I will say this though, compared to the face on Mars, this one here in that it really, I mean, it looks extremely symmetrical relative to the face on Mars. I'll give it that. But yeah, pretty interesting. All right, so now with all the suppressed technology that we've been talking about, I want to get into the secret space program and what you think about, I always had this suspicion that when it comes to, especially back in the Apollo missions, I mean, one thing's for certain, there is definitely a lot of just sketchy, what I might call fuckery surrounding the whole situation of the Apollo missions. And I always wonder, I'm sure we've been in space, but I'm just wondering, do we really do that by, strapping people to a firecracker and launching them up with a level of computer technology that we have in an alarm clock today? Or were they already using some of this technology and getting there in other means that they didn't want us to know about? And then that's why they put on the whole charade with the shuttles.
Yeah, that's my point of view, is that they had, I'm sure, in fact, I know they had anti-gravity technology by the mid-50s, and that Kennedy knew about it, and that he tried to spur on NASA to get to the moon by the end of the decade because he thought that it would, force them to release this technology. And of course they refused to do it because of the laws of war, which means that you have to keep everything secret, which I totally understand, although I think those reasons are long overdue and we need to release this technology. But they faked it. They faked it pretty well, and Kennedy died, and all of the secrets still remain hidden, although it looks like there's a soft disclosure going on at the moment, at least to tell us that there's something going on in the skies above us. But I'm not really satisfied with what the disclosure is going on right now. I've actually come to believe that the breakaway civilization or the secret space program is going to remain hidden for a little while longer until certain parts of the plan that they have can unfold, so that the release of this disclosed information will be the most effective. In other words, we're going to be in such dire straits that we're going to be begging for help, and we're not going to have enough energy and food and things to subsist, and then they're going to come along and save us. It's the Freemasonic plan, going back: out of chaos we create order. So they're creating chaos so that they can create order, and the secret space program is, this super advanced breakaway civilization that where all of our problems could be solved if we would just release the information, and they won't. So we're reliant on our masters to help us here, and they aren't going to do anything unless we somehow force the situation, which is one of the reasons I like the whole idea of storming one Area 51, even though I'm not really for storming Area 51 because it would be a terrible massacre.
Yeah.
But I like the idea of it because we know that inside Area 51 are all these anti-gravity secrets and free energy secrets and all these other things that they're hiding from us that they've been working on for 60 plus years. And, you know, I think that an examination of the technological rise after World War II can only reveal that this is what's going on.
Yeah, and do you yeah, and so and really there's no I wonder, you know, because when you go back to World War II, I mean, you know, like it or not, you know, the Nazis were it really does seem like they stumbled across some technology, or maybe it was given to them, or whatever the case may be.
Yeah, we don't know. But they had it definitely, and they were the precursors, although from our Project X interview with Walter Bosley, it does appear that it was going on long before the Germans were, well, the Nazis, but the German people were involved in it. And so I think that we've had this secret breakaway civilization slowly forming since about 1800 maybe, and they've been working and financing this and taking the best minds and removing them from it's sort of like that book by what's her name, the right wing woman who wrote the book about the breakaway civilization in the 1950s that they made the movies about, and Ayn Rand. And I think that maybe she even knew about it, because I don't believe in coincidences, and I can't believe that Ayn Rand in the 1950s is writing about a breakaway civilization in fiction when I actually can see evidence that there was a breakaway civilization in reality.
Yeah, and I mean, especially back then, a lot of times the best way to really get ideas or, you know, get your opinion out there is actually through fiction, especially, you know, because otherwise you might get, you know, ridiculed and shunned and you might just, you know, look like a moron to the majority of the people. But if you put the idea out there in a fictional form, you're still getting the idea out. And then, you know, generations later, they can look back and, you know, just like you said, it's like, okay, they knew something.
Or they're using fiction as a precog device to get us ready for events, just like the book that came out 10 years before the Titanic sank and right. predicted the exact Titanic disaster, or the number of precursor things that came out, like the Lone Gunman episode in April 2001, which predicted an airplane crashing into the World Trade Center, or all a number of precognitive events that seem to be going on, which are telling us about what's going to happen.
Yeah.
In other words, it's not really a coincidence or a break in the time-space continuum. It's actually a device that the people that are controlling us are using to mess with our minds.
Yeah, indeed. Now, okay, a few different directions we can go here. Now, you've done quite a bit of research into Stanley Kubrick. And what happened to him? Do you think... you know, what do you, that last movie that he wasn't able to finish and got in the hands of other people, and it really turned out to, you know, be something, you know, quite different than what his original vision was. Is there any good sources of information that might indicate what he was going to try to get through that? And, do you suspect any foul play in the timing of his death? What do you think about that?
It could be. I mean, I don't know. I can tell you this. Making a film is extremely physical. And if you're not in bed for a week or two after a shoot, then you're not human. So he was in his 70s or late 60s. And so, you know, the shoot itself could kill you. I've been in a shoot and it can kill you. Believe me, working for 70, 80 days in a row, 16 hours a day will kill anybody. And so, you know, and you have to do it because you're on a budget and you're an artist and you have to do what you do and you're obsessed with what you're doing. And so, yeah, it could have killed him. And also the fact that he was smoking two packs of Marlboros a day probably didn't help either. But I do, and I seem to be the only one that seems to have contact with people, at least I'm willing to talk about it, that were involved in the production of Eyes Wide Shut and who knew Stanley. And they told me that the script to Eyes Wide Shut and the film that he shot was completely different than the released film, and that they took out most of the what he called MK Ultra programming that Kubrick had featured in the film. And what's interesting about that film is that in no way that I can think of in any way in all of his previous films has Kubrick ever talked about the occult. In fact, his atheistic origins, and he was an atheist, he says anyway, although when I read his Playboy interview, I don't see an atheist. I see an alchemist. But when I see Eyes Wide Shut and I see the occult references for the first time in Stanley Kubrick's career, I can't believe that's an accident. I believe that Kubrick wanted us to know it was, you know, he thought it was going to be his second to his last film. AI was going to be his last film. And I think he was bookending his career with AI and Eyes Wide Shut to deliver a very potent, powerful, and profound message that we are ruled by an elite who use technology and occult practices to achieve their ends.
Yeah, and so I wonder, you know, you've talked before about, well, I guess, Folconelli talking about how, you know, the split between, back in the 1700s, the split between, you know, the Illuminati, I guess you can say, and the Freemasons. And right. What's interesting is there's a book, it's pretty hard to find. In fact, IPD in the chat room tracked one down and then sent it to me. It's a book called Skepticism and Historical Knowledge. And the whole point of the book, the whole thing is getting out, which is very, it's very interesting and it's very solid. But basically the point is that right around that same date of the split between the Masons and Illuminati, that everything before that date, that we're taught in schools and about our history and whatnot is, for lack of a better term, just completely made up.
I rejected this scenario for years, but then I kept looking and into history and saying, you know, and everything just gets really murky between the years of 600 and about 1100. It is the craziest thing of all. You cannot really find much of anything. It's like the whole world just came to a close. And, you know, yeah, you have the Mongol invasions, which may have contributed to this, but there seems to be, you know, we call it the Dark Ages, of course, and we say it's the Dark Ages because we don't really know what's going on. But yeah, in the 1700s, there was this event called the Cutting of the Elm, which seems to be where the Freemasons or the Illuminati or whatever they are had a break. And in that break, it looks like one group went underground while the other group went overground. By overground, I mean they took over the world. And the other group realized that the overground group was really after them in a big time way. And the reason they were after them, I believe, is because the underground group kept the serious secrets of alchemy, which was the elixir of immortality and a lot of other chemical technologies, and that they could not allow. These came, of course, from an ancient society that existed on the earth like, you know, 15, 30, 20,000 years ago, maybe 50,000 years ago, a very advanced group of people that lived on this planet and had, I guess, basically understood the science of plasma, where they didn't need hardcore technology because they had perfected this science of plasma, which I believe alchemy is. Alchemy is the study of the science of plasma. And so this underground organization was really worried that if the secrets of immortality got out to the what we'll call the Illuminati, so we'll call the White Knights, are called, I don't know, the Brotherhood or something, and the Dark Knights are called the Illuminati. Well, the White Knights are doing everything they can to make sure the Illuminati cannot find them and discover them. And so what they do is they use techniques to shape human culture. And I believe they're at work heavily right now, trying to upend what's about to happen to us, which is going to be very, very, very bad. And so they're working through forces like you guys and Groovy and me and many other people that were at the UFO Congress to kind of upend the Illuminati thinks is the inevitable, which is the total takeover of the human mind and the human spirit and the human body. And so I don't think it's a given that this thing is going to happen. I think that I'm very optimistic. I think we're going to win. I think that even though they're censoring us on YouTube and trying to stop this kind of alchemical knowledge from coming forth, I believe that there are serious spiritual forces at work working with us, and that the Illuminati, because they don't really understand these spiritual forces that well, which is why what happened is that when the White Knights went underground, they removed that knowledge of the spiritual forces from the organization, which they did on purpose, and for this exact reason. And now they're spreading that knowledge out to us using synchronicity and coincidence as their device. And so I say to everyone over and over and over and over and over, if you have a synchronicity, if you have a coincidence, you better wake up. You better pay attention to what's going on, because you've just been told a headline information and you need to pay attention right away. And you can't wait and put it off till next Wednesday. You have to do it right now.
Yeah. I mean, synchronicities are definitely, you know, it's just, it's almost, you know, the universe or them rather, you know, letting you know of like, hey, you're heading the right direction here. Keep paying attention, you know? And so do you think that the world of alchemy and all this, you know, knowledge and technology and understanding of how the universe works, do you think that perhaps at one point in history, this knowledge was handed down to them from something or another type of people, or did they really discover this on their own? You know, like with Falconelli, for example, he knew more about, you know, nuclear technology that, you know, before the Manhattan Project had even begun. And, you know, where is this information coming from? Where did they get it?
Well, I think there was a very long civilization, and what they did was they, I think, They existed and then they were destroyed by a catastrophe 13,000 years ago, and then they somehow were able to survive for the most part this catastrophe, which Graham Hancock thinks is a comet hit. He could be right, 13,000 years ago, and that they try to retain that knowledge with the archaeology and buildings in Egypt, and that this was an attempt to retain this hundreds of thousands of year long information. And so when they built the pyramid complex at Giza, they had hieroglyphs on the outside of the pyramids, which were, of course, taken away by us dumb humans and put into buildings and destroyed. And so we don't know what they were really saying. We only have the underground hieroglyphs now. And they tell us a lot. And they seem to say that Egypt seemed to know that there was a storm coming. A storm on the horizon, a darkness coming, a arcanic wilderness about to envelop them, and that they needed to, put this knowledge down in symbolic meaning, hoping that we here in our day would one day recover it. And so this hundreds of thousands of year-long civilization understood a different kind of physics, the physics of Keshe, this Iranian guy, or what I'm trying to tell you. I'm not a physicist, so I never claimed to be that, but this physics would allow you to grow, apples the size of watermelons. And, Keshe talks about this, how you can use this in your garden to grow incredibly gigantic plants. And so what this this civilization did was that they understood through trial and error what we are and what this world is. And they understood etheric physics and plasma physics, and they applied it in a way that we can't. So the pyramid, I don't know if you know who Christopher Dunn is, but he's a guy who's written books about the pyramid as being a power source. And that's exactly what it is. It's a plasma power source. It's using the underground rivers that go underneath it. The same thing with cathedrals in Europe. The Templars came back from their foray into the Middle East, and they came back with sacred knowledge. And as soon as the Templars came back from the Middle East to Europe, they create all of a sudden alchemy is suddenly created. The 500 cathedrals are built within 250 years. There's this huge Renaissance, which leads to the Reformation, which leads to science and leads to all the incredible things that Europe invented. And this is all because of this deep understanding of alchemy, which again, because you can't see plasma, you can't measure it and weigh it, it can't exist within the confines of our new physical science, so therefore it's not even talked about. And so the great science of our ancestors is now lost, and I think Groovy too is trying to do everything we can to like reboot this and get it going again.
Yeah, and here's a random question. Does plasma or even just fire, like, does it have does fire weigh anything? Does plasma have a weight to it? Like, if you somehow put it on a scale, would it weigh something?
Nope. Absolutely not. In fact, most your plasma is translucent. You can't even see it. It is what I call, it is what the physicists call dark matter. So they weigh a galaxy, and they can do this, and they see that the galaxy actually is larger than it appears, but there's no matter in the outlying artifacts outside the physical construct of the galaxy, and they can't figure it out what it is. And it's the plasma. The plasma is the dark matter, and it's 100,000 times more than the physical matter. So if you look at a galaxy, you look at the spiral arms and the glowing lights and all that, the plasma energy around that ring is hundreds of thousands of times bigger. So that accounts for this dark energy. And inside that sphere of dark energy, which sits around the physical energy of the galaxy, are literally hundreds of millions of beings, living beings that are not carbon-based, that interact with us in all physical matter. And it's actually the most fascinating theory ever, I think.
Yeah, and okay, so now let's see, with the time we have left, how about this? We did want to get into a little bit of Bigfoot, and I'll tell you one thing. You know, it's just we've hardly ever done episodes about Bigfoot, not exactly by design. It's just it just never comes up on the show, really. But my thing with Bigfoot is there's just first of all, you have a pretty interesting story, if I'm not mistaken. Of a camping trip of yours, Jay. Do divulge.
I don't have one, but I think Groovy does.
Oh, maybe I got confused. Oh, was that you, Groovy? Okay.
It was.
Yes, it was.
I've never seen
yes,
a Bigfoot, but
it is
she
a very
has.
Interesting... Yes, no, it's an interesting story, but I had so much more I wanted to say to the Secret Space Program and Project X and all that, but I know you're crunched on time there. But
no,
that's okay.
Pump the brakes and let's go back to that then. Let's go back to that. I do want to hear what you have to say. So.
You were talking about, you know, the Secret Space Program and. We were talking about Storm in Area 51, and I just wanted to share my thought on that. I think the key thing is for folks to be safe. I don't think it's smart to storm it, but I think the idea of storming Area 51 reflects, and it reflects the desire for truth. It reflects, you know what I mean? That we all want answers. We want to know, and that's the beauty of it. That's what I find about storming Area 51. So if anybody is going there, please be safe, right?
Yeah.
And then as far as, like, disclosures going, I don't think we're ever going to have full disclosure, but there's soft disclosure all the time. And actually, there was a recent news article that we were just talking about the other night at dinner. I can't remember because it's been such a blur, but the Air Force space plane. The mysterious Air Force space plane, right? It spent 719 days in orbit, breaking records, and this was supposed to be the fifth event. But the interesting thing is that it's a X-37B. And so, Jay, when you were talking about Project X, it just dawned on me, and then you talked about synchronicities. You're just thinking about the name of the Boeing. It's the X-37B.
Yep.
And it had broke the record for the most amount of time in space, right? Spent in space in the Earth's orbit. But then you have to question, okay, is this a little drip, 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 soft disclosure here? And what really is going on? But I just think this is a perfect example of that. Now, what to believe out of that? I don't know. But I just think it's is it preparing the public for what's really going on? Is that possible? You know, or is this just trying to do some mind programming to make you think that, you know, it just started because, you know, 5 years, 719 days in space. So they always put information out and it's usually, you know, in my opinion, 30, 40 years old.
Right.
So how long have they really been up there and what are they really doing? If this is did you all see that article?
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
And
right. So I was just, you know, that was just some things there I wanted to mention among others, but
there is slow disclosure, and they're letting stuff out. Sure, the Space Force that Trump is talking about is part of this.
Right.
They're going to use it as their kind of thing to just, you know, release secrets. And of course, we know also that, you know, they release these secret space program secrets through corporations. There's corporate mm-hmm. shells that are designed to release some of this technology, you know, to the public, and they do it surreptitiously through American corporations. I believe Apple and Google and Facebook are companies that are. They didn't really develop those technologies. They were developed in the secret space program, and then they were slowly released to the public. And there's a lot of stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right. And did anybody – here's a question for the audience, too, and just anybody in general. If you look at the – so it's the Space Command, I believe is what they're calling it, right, Trump, and you see that new flag and you see their emblem and their sigil. Has anybody out there, and maybe even the chat room, if you look at the emblem of the Space Command, you see the Earth, and it's got these ley lines going across. I haven't had time yet to blow up where the ley lines cross on the map. Hmm. So just kind of posing that idea out for everybody, because it's just one of those things I would like to research, or if anybody out there knows. But do you know what I'm talking about, the flag that they did?
Yeah, I'm looking at it right now. Interesting
question.
Okay,
you see where they cross? I just find that interesting, and just the symbology of the flag itself. It needs to be looked at.
I think so.
Right?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
And if you really look into it, there's always some deep symbology in especially a lot of NASA's missions, you know, a lot of reoccurring symbols. And I've seen guys just over, you know, deeply analyze it and point out, like, it does seem to be a way, you know, it's like a wink and a nudge towards something, towards those who get it, you know? So yeah, that's interesting. It's very interesting. Now,
And, sorry, there was feedback there. Yeah, symbology is everything. So,
I think you and I agree. We were talking about the other night how, you know, this whole community, you know, everybody's, you know, we want disclosure and we want it now, and we all feel we're ready to handle it. But at the same time, I kind of wonder, because I have a good friend of mine who we all experienced and saw something. There was three of us. Two of us, you know, we're just fine. But him, it really, I mean, it just blew wide open his understanding of reality and possibilities. And he literally went crazy for a while after that. And he's never quite fully recovered. It was such a huge, level of disclosure for him that it really, it stirred him up. And to this day, he hasn't really made a full recovery. So I don't know. Do you really? It just makes me wonder if we are really, you know, as a whole, as a society, if in fact we are ready for just a bam, full-blown disclosure. And is that why they're, you know, perhaps maybe they are drip-feeding this disclosure, perhaps for our own good? Just an idea. I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, I just question, you know, the drips of disclosure, I just try to look at from both angles. Is this programming, is this a test? Is what they're putting out a test, or is it legit? How do you find that out? Right, all you can do is research. Now, if full-blown disclosure happened, I'm actually a bit concerned for humanity, because we have a very hard time getting along one another, right? We have problems with our neighbors. We have problems with, I mean, look at us. We need to pull our stuff together.
Yeah.
If we truly want disclosure, because if disclosure happened, that would just be... would it be the end of us? Think about that. could that happen? Because people just wouldn't know what to do. And you just look at the structure of what we're dealing with now as a society and a system. And there's many issues. So sorry, I keep getting feedback. I'm not sure what that is, but I hope that makes sense.
Yeah, it does. Everything sounds good on my end. And yeah, I mean, especially if we're going to start, you know, really interacting with, you know, join the galactic community, if it were, as it were, of other races and whatnot, we should probably figure out how to have team human first, you know, and and so that we can really represent ourselves, you know, as one team. But yeah, I agree. Now,
yeah.
All right, now, I do want to get into some Bigfoot though, and yeah, I am curious to hear your story. I heard it was one for the books.
Okay, well, I'm not sure if it's what it's a fascinating story and it's a fun one, but it was also a bit scary. So I was camping. I was 13 years old and with my friend, and we, you know, hip teenagers wanting to be all cool and everything, and we were going on a camping trip. Actually, this was in Arizona. And going on a camping trip, and we, you know, as hip and cool as we thought we were, we thought we would set up our two-man tent. It was about maybe 100 to 200 feet away from the family unit, right? And so we're hanging out, we're in the tent, we're both laying flat, and it was just a really, really, really small tent, clear night, all good, you know, the beautiful stars of Arizona and the smells and just that yummy divinity of nature. And we're hanging out being the quirky teens that we are, but we were smelling some foul smells, put it that way, and hearing some rustling. And we had a flashlight, and you're laying flat in the tent and looking up at the tent, you know, you have the triangle, what's it called? The two-man tent. So anyhow, there is a large breathing sounds, and a face starts to push. So if you take a sheet and you're pushing your face through a sheet, okay, so think of it that way. Okay. So a face starts to come through the top of the tent and just the most pungent of smells. But so we're looking up, we have our flashlights up, and we see this, this is the size of this, I don't know, 15 by 15, just as I'm looking at my computer here, just gigantor face coming in through the tent. And you could see the hair, you could see the mass, you could see the size. And of course, us cool 13-year-olds just start screaming. But the Bigfoot, he was making, and I say he because that's just how it felt, very large, makes this almost, you know, when a bull at a rodeo is like making those, yeah. I don't even know how that's going to come across on air, but those, what would you say those sounds are, Jay? Yeah, there you go. Totally, yeah. So making those sounds, we just see, and I mean straight down from the tent, the hot rate. So we're screaming, and it kept making those hoofing, breathing sounds. And I mean, I'm sure we woke up everybody at the campground, but I can hear one of my parents screaming, I'm coming, screaming, and we just hear these enormous, enormous footprints stomp off, just boom, 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 just go right off. And when one of my parents came up, are you okay, are you okay, are you okay, he could smell it. So that was, needless to say, we were not the hip, cool 13-year-olds we thought we were, and we went back down with all the other members that were at the campground. And I'm trying to think I don't think that I've slept that far away from anybody since then, yeah, or by myself for that matter. But it, I'll tell you, the face, I mean, it was a face, and you could see hair and mass, and smells, and it was just holy crap there. So that
well, Bigfoot does like teenage girls. I've enough research to tell you that I've talked to a number of women who are not teenagers anymore, but like Groovy, they had experience when they were teenagers,
right?
And Bigfoot has an affinity for younger humans. I don't know if it's sexual or what it is, but they're fascinated by it. In fact, I was told by a very, very advanced, older Bigfoot researcher that if you really, and I shouldn't tell you this, but I'm going to, I hope if you do it with responsibility. But if you really want to see a Bigfoot, what you should do is record children playing in a playground and then go out in the woods and play that recording over and over in a loop.
Huh.
And then stand away about 40 yards with your camera, and you'll almost inevitably see a Bigfoot because he's fascinated by human children.
Interesting idea. Interesting idea. Okay, and so what do you two think is... Because here's the thing with Bigfoot for me. You know, on one side of things, cultures from all around the world, as far as history goes back, describes Bigfoot, whether they call it Yeti or what have you. It's there. It's in the history. So obviously, people, they're not talking just about nothing at all. You know, there's obviously some basis to this. But then on the other hand, I'm just kind of surprised that there's not a lot of, evidence, physical evidence, you know, with all the researchers that are out there, you know, doing the good work every day, the evidence hasn't come along as quickly as I would imagine it has, like, you know, say for the UFO community, for example, and all this, it's been getting really mainstream these last couple of years with the government programs and everything else and these videos. There's no like really great like smoking gun sort of evidence for Bigfoot yet, and I'm just why do you think that is? Because it's certainly not a lack of trying, because there's people out there every day.
Yeah, I think a lot of it is, well, first off, the habitat is dying away, so I think Bigfoot itself is dying away. Just because the habitat is dying away, and which is a very tragic thing. And but also, this is one incredibly intelligent, elusive creature. And I don't know if you've ever seen the IMAX photography of where they're out in Wyoming shooting a bison herd, and there's definitely a Bigfoot walking around inside the bison herd. And and when you watch that footage, you realize how incredibly elusive they are. And to be honest with you, if you actually take the wilderness of, say, the United States and you examine it, you realize that because of fear and the Forest Service rulings, most people just stay on the trails.
Right.
So if you just take the trails, you're only talking about 1-2% of the entire national wilderness area that people actually even visit. The rest of it's just completely not visited. And there could be anything out there. And since, you know, they tell you, don't go off the trail, you'll die. So no one ever goes off the trail. Well, I go off the trail. That's what I do. I have a GPS and I go off the trail and I find evidence, and I find evidence of all sorts of things. And, you know, logs stacked up against trees and footprints and all sorts of things. But you have to go off the trail, and most people don't. But again, if you really want to attract Bigfoot, he's into little children, not sexually. He's just attracted to it for whatever reasons. And in fact, most of the verifiable Bigfoot sightings involve children or young teenagers, usually girls, by the way.
Yeah, and what do you think about, you know, I'm thinking about all those missing 411 cases that happen in those environments. Would you suspect at all that maybe some of these disappearances could be Bigfoot related?
I think some of them are. My good friend David Politis, who wrote those books, he thinks that there's something else going on. Probably a transdimensional, again, plasmic experience, although there are physical animals that are out there, not just Bigfoot, but Dogman, which is a 7-foot-tall upright creature that has a dog face but human body, except for the legs, which are dog-shaped. And there's been so many of these sightings. And they're recent. They're not. There is a history of Dogman sightings going back thousands of years, but in the last 15 years, there's been a huge uptick in sightings of these Dogman creatures. I don't know if there's genetic experiments going on. Chris O'Brien wrote the San Luis Valley books. He thinks that there is some kind of hybrid thing going on, probably a Dulce in New Mexico, but I don't know. But I don't think Bigfoot is a hybrid or an invention, but I do believe there's other animals which are starting to appear recently, which seem to be results of experiments going on in labs, and maybe they escaped, or who knows, right? The fact that all these sightings are around the secret bases at Dulce and in the San Luis Valley and in the Smoky Mountains makes me think that there's something nefarious going on.
Okay. And so what do you, both of you, what do you guys think about the whole the theory of Bigfoot being potentially multidimensional?
I'll let Groovy say that first, and then I'll comment.
All right.
Okay. Oh, sorry, I had to get my mic on there. I'm thinking about it because what do I think about Bigfoot being multidimensional? Well, I think it's an interesting ideology. Could it be possible? Sure. But I'd like to see, I think about just finding Bigfoot here before even going there. Does that make sense? I think, right. And I also would like to point out what if there is somebody out there or a team of people that actually do have legit footage, but they're protecting Bigfoot. That's what I like to think about because I think about the ethics of it. I think about, if for those real, you know, the beautiful nature lovers out there, what if I like to think that. I like to think that it has been documented, and what's happening is they're being protected. Because, again, we talked about, you know, what would happen if disclosure happens. Well, Bigfoot would be involved in that disclosure, and, you know, there's so much, you know, I would hate to see something be wiped out, right? Be hunted and wiped out.
Yeah. That's what I'm afraid of, and I agree with you completely, Groovy, because I'm actually on a mission to get physical evidence, and I've made a kind of a compact with myself that I will never tell anyone where I gathered that evidence. And the only reason that I'm trying to gather evidence of the existence of this creature, and I don't believe he's an etheric creature, although I do believe that Bigfoot can see into the electromagnetic spectrum and can see where the natural portals lie, so he can use them to get in and out of bad situations. But I just want to finish my thought, and that is that the reason I am interested is I'm trying to prove that he exists, it exists, she exists, not because I want hunters to go after him. God, I don't want that at all. What I want is federal protection, that if you hurt one of these creatures, you have committed murder and should be prosecuted.
Yeah. I hear you. Yeah. And I agree. And, you know, well, I'll tell you what, we're got about 5 minutes left here. So, what's now you've got your show Reality Check. For those of you that don't know, it's on YouTube. Lots of great content they have over there. But what's in the future for both of you guys? Do you have any other projects you're working on, or that you can talk about anyway? As far as you know, you're producing Jay and Groovy, whatever else you might be working on. Do you got anything up your sleeves coming up?
Well, I'm writing a couple of books, and I really want to take Reality Check and turn it into a show that kind of is a umbrella show that reveals several aspects about what's going on and connects them or interconnects them. And so I view Reality Check as kind of a social experiment that I'd like to do. And I think that Groovy's an integral part of that because we both kind of agree on what's going on in our reality right now. But you know, no, I don't. I realize that there's no real place for me to release documentaries anymore because they've destroyed the DVD market. And I'm under the, you know, the auspices of, you know, Google and Netflix and Gaia and everybody else. And they may not like where I'm going with my films. So I realize that if I can play within the rules of YouTube and BitChute and all the other emerging platforms, that is really the way to express myself in the most effective way.
Yeah, and
I'm going to interject for one sec, Gigi. Hey, Jay, could you clarify social experiments, please? Because I was a part of a medical experiment, no. And I think it's important to clarify what you meant by that.
No, I don't mean that. I mean that YouTubers like all of us can use the YouTube and other platforms to experiment with new ideas that will affect social change.
Got it. Thank you.
Yes. All right. And have you guys looked into BitMovio at all?
We have. We talked to the guys who started it, and we're very interested in it. And I think that it actually is the future. There's several platforms being developed by younger people that are determined to not let censorship affect their lives. And if you're listening, I encourage you to go forth because that is the future. And we can create platforms that allow the free expression of ideas and the anti-censorship. And that is where we're going. And I do not believe in slippery slopes. I don't believe that because YouTube and other platforms are censoring us, that that's the end of the game. I think that we can outsmart them at every turn, and we will.
And can I add to, you know, what's going on next here besides Reality Check? There's another discussion we're going to be launching. Me and my friend Lisa Tenney will be launching that pretty soon. And also, for me, I was recently published, but I'm also writing an addition to what was published through a medical textbook, and I want to talk about the medical black operations programs.
Yeah, Groovy wants to become like the next John Rappaport. John Rappaport is, of course, a few years old, and was a great investigator into medical criminality, and there's nobody to take the place, so I'm encouraging Groovy to become that replacement because John Rappaport was an amazing guy. He is an amazing guy. He's still here with us. And one of my great heroes, and he uncovered so much about the FDA and the other agencies, the CDC. And we really need a voice to come forth that can expose what's really going on in the medical field.
All right. All right. Yeah. And, okay, well, listen, I'm sure you're all just as exhausted as I am from from this whole last weekend, so thanks for taking the time to come on the B-Sides tonight, but we will certainly have to have you guys back on for our main network show sometime in the near future, and I very much look forward to that. So, yeah, just thanks again, and had a blast hanging out with you guys all weekend, and we'll definitely talk to you very much sooner than later.
Sounds good.
Thank you very much. Yeah, thanks to the chat, too. Thanks.
All right, and with that, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to boogie on out of here. This show is hosted and produced by yours truly, associate producer Brad Harris. You can follow him on Twitter, @ADSBradHarris. And yeah, thanks for tuning in, guys. And look forward to this Friday with Jeremy Corbell. Don't want to miss that one. All right, folks, have a fantastic rest of your Sunday. We'll see you on the other side. Cheers.